Right, I was not sure what to call this. Alternative might be the largest explosion you'll ever see. Right, there are a series of strains to this, mostly related to Nobel Prizes, and of the five Nobel Prizes, three people who didn't actually get them for rather strange reasons. So, and the story start has several different strands. One of the good places to start is with the 1963 nuclear test ban treaty. The Americans didn't trust the Russians, so they put up some satellites to detect candidate explosions, and one of the detectors was a gamma ray detector. And what did they detect? The gamma ray bursts. About one every second day, which clearly wasn't coming from the Russians. Wasn't clear where it was coming from. It was all very secret, so they didn't tell anybody about this until they finally declassified it 10 years later and suggested that it may have been coming from the center of our galaxy, which would imply the extremely powerful source. These flashes of gamma rays are actually the brightest thing in the sky in the gamma ray spectrum. So there's what, that's actually two of the satellites. They launched them in pairs. So those are the spy satellites. When it was declassified, NASA had a look and put up a satellite to detect where these are coming from. So they put up a satellite Compton Gamma Ray Observatory. And when a burst was detected, it would give a direction, a message would go out to astronomers, see what you could find, but they never found anything. Unfortunately, the gamma ray is not a very accurate direction. So they produced a map of where they're coming from. There's the map there. So basically, they're coming from all over the sky, which means they're coming from some distant object. Yeah, instead of being an extremely strong source in the center of the galaxy, it's a source many times further away and many times more powerful. Right, the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory lost stabilizers, and while it was still controllable, it was ditched in the Pacific Ocean while still working. It was eventually replaced by Fermi satellite there, which was launched in 2008 with a 10-year life. It's running out now, but it's still working happily. Right, the next area we need to look at is life as stars, how that impacts on our story. So they're formed from gases of almost all hydrogen, and the initial stars were virtually all hydrogen. They collapse under gravity until it gets hot and dense enough to nuclear reaction of hydrogen going into helium. And then other reaction, when it runs out of hydrogen, there's a reaction with helium, which we'll come back to. And finally goes through a series of reactions until producing mainly iron. When these reactions finish, small stars like our sun slowly cool down over the next few billion years. larger stars lack the forces to resist the gravity holding them up and go into a runaway gravitational collapse and a huge explosion. This throws the outer layers into space and puts elements that is generated out into space. But the elements being generated only go up to iron, which is the most stable element. And you'll be well aware that there's a lot of heavier elements about. That's a problem. And the center goes, when it all collapses in on gravity, the more closer it gets, the faster it goes. And the center gets compressed into something called a compact object, which is so compact that atoms are actually destroyed, and it goes to a density something like the density of atomic nuclear, a thing known as a neutron star. Small ones have an escape velocity of perhaps half the velocity of light. These things have mass of 1.5-2 times the sun in a 10 or 20 kilometer radius, and the escape velocity is about half the velocity of light. If they get a bit bigger, the escape velocity becomes the velocity of light, and that's the end of what you see of it, and it's a black hole. Right, so the material ejected in these explosions forms new stars, and you've got something solid to make planets out of. We've probably been through a couple of cycles of this, and we're made largely of the material from these explosions of stars. So we come to Fred Hoyle. He worked out the sequence of reactions in stars with his associates in the 1940s and 50s. He had a problem. He needed a special property of carbon atoms for this to work. If you don't have this special property, you don't have a universe with any higher elements, and we wouldn't be here. So he went along to Caltech, knocked on the door of the nuclear physicist, said you have to look for a resonance in carbon nucleus of about 7.7 MeV. Because you won't be here if it's not there. They were rather skeptical. After he went away, they found a student with nothing to do and said, why don't you go and look for this Hoyle residence? Gave him some old equipment, and sure enough, he found it. It was published with Hoyle's name as the first Hoyle author. Right, Hoyle was a rather obnoxious Yorkshireman. So he came up with a lot of theories, including this one with carbon. Most of the rest have been well forgotten. He got into an argument with the Nobel Committee over one Justin Bell 1974 prize. He was forced to issue an apology. We'll come back to Justin Bell. His co-workers, William Feller and Chandra Shekhar, won the Nobel Prize in 1983 for this work, but Hoyle was omitted. Nobel Prizes can be given to three people, it was given to two. This was rather controversial. It was blamed partly on the argument he'd had with the Nobel Committee, but also the main paper they'd published, which Hoyle was an author, actually four authors, actually forgot to reference the paper, earlier papers by Hoyle. So Feller and Chandrasekhar actually shared their prize money with Hoyle. We move on to another strand is general relativity. It was developed by Einstein in 1917, and it confused everybody. It relates space, time, and gravity in a very innovative way, and is one of the basic theories of physics, the other being quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics was developed by a whole range of people, including Einstein made some steps in quantum mechanics. General relativity was largely developed by Einstein himself. Right, quantum mechanics and general relativity are the two major theories of physics. They're both highly accurate, but they don't agree. General relativity predicts the bending of light, and for compact masses like those from dead star explosions, supernova, mass gets so high that the light is bent round in circles. It's not quite clear what happens inside, but it doesn't come out. So you have the black hole. So he predicts general relativity predicts black holes, and large stars collapse to black holes, and some have been found. It also predicts gravity waves, which is the one we'll be looking at to some extent. Right, Einstein did get a Nobel Prize for his advances in physics, but not for general relativity, but for other work. There were two later Nobel Prizes for verifying general relativity. Gravity waves have now been confirmed. Black holes are now thought to be the center of most or possibly all galaxies. And it's not clear how they get to the center of galaxies, but they're hugely massive, billions of times the mass of the Sun. And smaller ones from the collapse of burnt out large stars. Right here is Jocelyn Bell. She was a PhD student working on radio astronomy, studying quasars, which are basically stars being eaten up by large black holes. She had a radio astronomy aerial. That's your little bang. The aerial she had was a series of dipoles, two wires planted out in a paddock, a couple of paddocks. Apparently they got a whole lot of students there planting them out, and then she was set to work on it. She found a radio source giving fast, regular spikes, became known as pulses. Nobody was expecting fast pulses from anywhere in the sky. The sky is filled with large objects which move relatively slowly. These things were going beep, 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 beep. About every second, some of them are milliseconds. Her supervisor said it might be a nearby military establishment, and clearly wasn't. So they said it might be reflections off the moon. She said, no, it's moving across the sky fixed with the stars. There's the actual first recording. She had to get a special recorder. She'd noticed that the signal was a little bit peculiar. It seemed to be a bit more random than it should be. And she managed to get a faster recorder, and there she found these beeps. There was various suggestions that it was little green men trying to contact us, sending us a message. It wasn't a very exciting message. It just goes beep, beep, beep. So the supervisors were quite sceptical about this. So she found three more similar sources in the sky. So there was definitely something up there going beep, beep, beep. She published the results with her supervisors, Huish and Sir Martin Royal. Royal had actually developed the type of telescope she was using. She was told she couldn't change the title of the thesis, so she put the pulse of work in the back of the appendix. Her supervisor apparently only read the first chapter and gave it back to her. Hoyle and many other, the 1974 Nobel Prize was given to her supervisors. And again, two, although it's available for three, and quite a few people got very unhappy about her omission from this. So, Nobel Prizes aren't typically given to students or to females. So, she went on to a successful career in radio astronomy. She had a knighthood, and she's now Chancellor, I see, of the University of Dundee. So she doesn't seem to have retired. She's approximately my age. Right, so pulses were identified as coming from neutron stars, these very compact objects, a few kilometers in diameter, which means they can give fast pulses. They rotate and have a magnetic field which sends out a beam of radio signals, which are the pulses you see going past. Some of them are directed towards the Earth and some of them are not. There's a reasonable number of them out there. So the atoms are compressed out of existence, so only neutrons remain. Rather nasty objects, you wouldn't go near them. So they produce regular radio pulses, very, very regular in fact. You can set your atomic clock by them. So the next part of the story is another couple of astronomers, Huss and Taylor. They discovered a pulsar wheel pulse that varied in time consistently. So it should be giving a very steady output, and this one had a systematic variation in it, just what an astronomer wants, a very accurate clock in orbit about something else. So they can look at the timing of this, work out what its orbit and properties of what it's going around. So they've got the orbit and masses. It was going around something small. It was in an orbit perhaps twice the size of the moon's orbit and going around about every 5 days, if I remember. So the object that was going around again was very heavy, a couple of masses of the sun. So it wasn't an ordinary star, so it turned out to be another neutron star. It wasn't heavy enough to be a black hole. And they found the period of the orbit was changing slowly due to the generation of gravity waves. So Einstein said if you have two big masses going around, they will generate gravity waves. So the solar system, particularly mainly Jupiter, generates gravity waves as it goes around the sun, about 5 kilowatts, rather trivial amount. This one was generating about 10 to the power 20 kilowatts. And it was losing energy due to these gravity waves going out and slowly going into a tighter and tighter orbit. And this agreed exactly with general relativity. There's his graph showing how the cumulative orbit rate is changing. Turns out to be a parabola because over the time period it's simply losing a constant amount of energy. So Hirst and Taylor were awarded the 1993 prize for verifying the existence of gravity waves. So orbiting neutron stars, the loss of energy and gravity waves causes the pairs to move in closer, and as they move in closer they go faster and generate more gravity waves, and so it goes on drawing more and more intense gravity waves. And finally something drastic happens and these two neutron stars collide. There's a few pairs of them about. First two discovered are going to collide in about 300 million years. Get down the mine when that happens. And when they do collide, there's an absolute massive release of energy. It's the biggest explosion you'll ever see. Thousands of times more than the collapsing star. So they go faster and faster as they rotate. They end up traveling about a third of the velocity of light. And exactly what happens next, we're not sure. But something exciting is bound to happen. And the gravity waves get more and more intense, and it was predicted that the gravity waves just before collisions of neutron stars should be detectable. So it was be rather an exciting thing to detect. And $1 billion project was set up, building two and more recently a third detector has been installed. Basically an interferometer, two arms at right angles. You send a split light beam along each of them. And if a gravity wave goes past, it alters the length of one of the arms, or two differently, and when the beam comes back, you see it in the photo detector. It's the most sensitive instrument that's ever been built. There's the library Livingston in Louisiana. You can see the two arms going out, a couple of kilometers long, evacuated, masses strung at the end, highly isolated from the environment. And they're looking for fractions of movement of a nucleus of an atom. So that's one, and the other one in the USA is in Hanford, Washington, much the same arrangement. And they actually, when they go they went into operation, and then they went out of operation to be upgraded. I'm not sure if they're still operating or they're due for another upgrade. And the third one only came into operation last year, which is Virgo in Italy, same sort of arrangement. Right. So the first gravity wave was detected in September 14th, 2015. And it turned out to be colliding black holes, which they weren't expecting. Unlike the gamma ray bursts, where they immediately send out an automatic message to anybody who wants to look for them. Must have got a bit tired of looking for them as the messages come out every couple of days. Gamma ray information was all embargoed for 2 months. And anybody who had signed up to get it had signed that they won't say anything about it. And the first one went out to the people who'd signed up, and they wouldn't say whether it was actual detection or whether it was a test signal inserted to see how people would go. And by 2 months they were rather annoyed about this. We wasted all our time analysing these signals. Which might be just a test signal. Right, the analysis of the wave detected gives us quite a lot of information in rather a fairly small bit of wave form. We'll have a look at that in a moment. And it also gives the distance, which is very interesting. Gives an entirely independent way of getting distances to celestial objects. The current method starts off with measuring the diameter of the Earth's orbit, parallaxes of stars, then certain variable stars which are consistent, and then certain supernova explosions, one particular type is particularly consistent, and then to red shifts as the universe expands. So there's a whole series of these, all of them are a bit doubtful, so an independent measurement is great. And one problem, you can't tell where the black holes are, so you can't line this up with anything you know. The black holes detected were a size not previously known, and all their detections were of colliding black holes. They built these things for looking for colliding neutron stars. But how does that show up? Not too bad. So up the top is the wave signal from the first one. The second one has a different notation because they're not sure if it was there or not, so it didn't pass the statistical tests. It looks quite good in this. And there's a couple more which have been detected. So these were, and the last one was also detected. I'm not sure. So I think they're all detected by LIGO. And you'll see the time scale there, 1 or 2 seconds. So they just get a short burst and go away and spend their time analyzing. And a fairly small number of wave cycles. Tens of a few tens. Right, there's the masses of them. So the first one was rather largest one, turned out to be a long way away. Something like, I think, 3 billion light years. And here is their diagram of locating them. So the first three, they only had the two US detectors, and they could say it's somewhere right over there in the sky. Two of them, one down the bottom, 2017-8-14, had the Italian detector, which rather limited it, where it was in the sky. And the last one over the other side, 8-17, also three detectors were up, and we'll come back to that one. Right, so the last Nobel Prize in physics was for the detection of black hole detectors. Three people from US universities were given the prize. The actual paper on it had some thousands of authors, and there were a cast of several thousand working on the detectors. Right, so there's the event of last year, 17th of August. A clear signal was detected by Ryder Hanford, over 60 seconds long. Clearly something different. The automatic detection of signals sits on each of these gravity wave detectors. At Livingston, didn't report anything. And Virgo in Italy didn't see anything. So, not all was going quite according to plan. However, a manual inspection of Livingston showed a clear signal, but it had one of their glitches in the middle of it, so it wasn't reported. However, they got the signal out. Most glitch was only a few seconds, and it was quite analysable. At Virgo, it happened to be pointing in the wrong direction. So they have a blind spot. This wasn't quite as bad as it sounds, because they knew where the blind spot was, so they could use that to increase the accuracy of their location. There's the glitch. And outside the glitch is the actual signal that was received. It was 30 or 40 cycles per second, which doesn't show up on this timescale. So the signal they received went on for about a minute, started at about 30 cycles a second, and slowly increased initially, and then increased more rapidly and more rapidly until it was going at 2,000 cycles a second, which means these things were going around each other 2,000 times a second. And if you do the calculation, they must be pretty close up there. 10, 20 meters, kilometers in diameter, and they must be traveling at a significant portion of the velocity of light at this stage. It's estimated about a third the velocity of light. it's very different from what they previously detected. Went over a range. It was approximately 3,000 cycles they recorded, compared with tens or less of cycles they'd seen previously. It was analyzed as colliding neutron stars, each a mass of about two solar masses, and about 1.7 seconds later, a gamma ray burst was detected by the Fermi satellite. Fortunately, this one doesn't have time scales on it. But the top one is the satellite signal, and there's the gamma ray burst. And along here is the frequency analysis, going up from about 30 here, rapid, then rising at an absolutely rapid rate. When I first looked at these, I thought with a $2 billion project, you could draw a better graph of this curve. But it's actually the raw Fourier analysis of the signal. So it gives all the different frequencies, and you can see the domination of the particular main frequency in the signal. So exactly what happened in that 1.5 seconds is not clear. One of the best explanations is this was about 130 million light years away, and in traveling through a little bit of matter in space may have delayed the gamma ray signal slightly. So here's the location. So the lighter green is just from the LIGO, and with the extra information from Virgo, tied it down a bit further, and from the Fermi satellite and European one, produced a rather larger estimate of where it is, which is why you have a significant portion of the sky, and nobody had been able to detect where these gamma ray bursts were coming from. This happened to be a particularly near one, which meant that the gravity wave detectors could detect it. So, and those lines, so they're located about 20 or 30 galaxies that it might be in. I think about the fifth one they examined, they found it there, galaxy known as MGC 4993, originally discovered by Herschel. That's a UV image the next day. It was also observed in X-ray, optical, and later infrared and radio frequencies. So unlike the black hole collision, there was a lot to see. Another optical view. It doesn't look all that spectacular, but it was actually vastly outshining the galaxy it's in. And the spectrum showed formation of heavy elements. It was reported that there were about 2 Earth masses of gold produced there, and lots of other, a whole spectrum of all the heavy elements. 2 Earth masses of gold sounds rather excessive, but when you consider it was about 2 million Earth masses of matter involved in this collision, only a little bit got converted to gold, similar amounts to uranium, platinum, and other heavy elements. So this fills in a hole as to where heavy elements have come from. So there were a series of firsts from this event. Right, first detection of gravity waves coming from collision of neutron stars. Direct evidence that gamma ray bursts can be caused by colliding neutron stars. Detection of gravity wave and electronic waves from the same event. Confirmation that gravity waves travel at the speed of light. So Einstein said, my equation says they travel at the speed of light, and you better believe it. So until this, there was no evidence for what speed they travel. And confirmation of that heavy elements originate from neutron star collisions. And an independent measure of distance to a galaxy. So now they had both the gravity wave source and the galaxy, and they could check their distance measurements. And also, in fact, related to that, the age of the universe. So, Nobel Prize in Physics, it's not clear who will get it. There's thousands of people who worked on this, including a large number who worked on the previous detections. The Nobel Committee will meet probably about the 2nd of October, and announced shortly after. So it's yet to be seen what will happen. But generally, just thought that this is going to be the next Nobel Prize. Right, so that's it.
Thank you.